Welcome to Ceramic Pottery and Sculpture, Level 1, Unit 5. In the first two units, we talked about origins, ingredients, and properties of clay. In Units 3 and 4, we covered methods of construction, surface treatment, and glazing. In this final unit, we'll consider aesthetics as they relate to ceramic pottery and sculpture. Aesthetics is a set of principles concerned with the physical nature and appreciation of beauty, especially in the visual arts. To some degree, beauty is in the eye of the beholder. However, what we focus on in this unit is our ability to talk about why we do or do not perceive a piece as aesthetically pleasing. In this unit, we will cover the four aesthetic qualities of art, art categories, and some terms that relate specifically to ceramic, pottery, and sculpture. Understanding these concepts will help us talk about the work. Let's begin by identifying the different parts of a pot. There are six parts of a pot. As you can see, they relate to parts of the human figure. They are the lip, neck, shoulder, body, belly, and foot. This piece is an example of a pot that consists of all six parts. However, not all pots have all six parts. A teapot, for example, does not typically have a neck, just as a cylindrical bud vase would not have a shoulder or a belly. Now let's begin by introducing the four aesthetic qualities of art. They are sensory, formal, expressive, and technical. Sensory qualities refer to the elements of art, such as line, form, and color. Formal qualities refer to the principles of design, such as pattern, emphasis, and rhythm. Expressive qualities refer to the artist's voice, and technical qualities refer to the artist's approach. Let's look at each of these qualities in greater detail. We begin with sensory qualities. They are line, shape, form, texture, space, value, and color. Please make a note of the concepts related to each of these elements of art. A line can be straight or curved, it can be thick or thin. It can also be created when two fields come together. For example, in this picture of the ocean, a line is created where the sky meets the water. This line actually has a name. It's called the horizon line. A wavy line is created where the water meets the sand. And a line that follows the outside of an object is called an outline. Shape is a two-dimensional concept, such as a geometric circle, square, or triangle. The outline of an object, like a leaf, also creates a shape, an organic shape. Shapes can be representational or abstract. They can also be symbolic and carry significant meaning in a work of art. The polka dot shapes used to decorate this mug relate to the shape of the body of the mug as well as its circular lip and foot. Form is a three-dimensional concept, such as a sphere, a cube, or a cone. Most sculptures can be broken down into a series of simple forms. For example, a common vase can be considered a compound form, comprised of a sphere, a cylinder, and a cone. This white vase is made up of two geometric cones, while the rock sculpture makes use of organic forms. Texture is a surface quality that looks or feels rough. If you hold a pot in your hands and it feels rough, this would be an example of real texture. This plate has a design that is very busy. It feels smooth to the touch, but it has what we would call visual texture. The element of space is comprised of both positive and negative space. An actual object or subject represents positive space, while the air around or within that object represents negative space. In a painting or a drawing, the concept of space is implied. In sculpture, it can be both implied and real. Value refers to shade from light to dark. It can be low in contrast, such as in a painting of a foggy winter morning, or high in contrast, as it would be in a photograph of a traditional chessboard. Contrasting value can be real, as it is in this vase that incorporates two different colors of clay, or created by a light source, as seen in the examples of these three relief tiles. The last element of art is color, which is the most complex sensory quality of all. In fact, there are classes you can take in college that focus entirely on color and color theory. Here we consider color as a pigment. However, if you were to study stage lighting or photography, you would work with completely different properties of color. For example, if you mix red and green light, you get yellow. But if you mix red and green paint, you get brown. Glaze is even more complicated because the ingredients that affect the color of a glaze do not mix with predictable results. In addition, the method of firing can also influence the outcome of a color. Nevertheless, when critiquing the aesthetics of a piece, the properties of how different pigments mix together still applies. There are three primary colors. They are red, yellow, and blue. They cannot be created by mixing other colors together. However, these three colors can be used to make any color of the rainbow. When you mix two primary colors in equal increments, you get a secondary color. Red and yellow gives you orange. Yellow and blue gives you green. Blue and red gives you purple. Orange, green, and purple are referred to as secondary colors. Complementary colors are those colors opposite in the color wheel. For example, red and green are complementary. Colors close to blue are considered cool colors, and colors around orange are warm. Colors can also be symbolic of concepts such as love, sadness, envy, and anger. Hue refers to a specific color on the color wheel. Tints are created by adding different amounts of white to a hue. Shades are created by adding different amounts of black to a hue. And tones are created by adding different amounts of gray. That was a quick introduction to the elements of art, which are the sensory qualities. Now let's consider the formal qualities, which are the principles of design. They include pattern, contrast, emphasis, balance, scale, rhythm, and unity. Let's begin with pattern. Pattern is the repetition of something over and over. It's used in music, literature, dance, and drawing, as well as ceramic sculpture. It can include the repetition of elements of design such as color, shape, or form. Here we see a texture wheel that is simply a dowel with stars carved into it. When rolled into the clay, it creates an infinite pattern of stars. The next principle of design is contrast. This refers to difference or similarity. A great difference in something is considered high contrast. Little difference is low contrast. This set on the left shows high contrast in color. The vase on the right incorporates high contrast in texture. The blue glaze on that piece has a low or subtle contrast in tints of that hue. Emphasis is the main idea or focus of a piece. As illustrated in these four pieces, emphasis can be on the mass of a form, the story behind a rabbit with goggles, the functionality of a teapot, or the relationship between the human figure and the form of a vase. Balance refers to a sense of visual weight. In painting, it's perceived, but in sculpture, it can be real. A vase with a wide belly looks less attractive than a vase with a narrow belly, even when the narrow vase looks precarious, as if it might fall over. One solution potters have incorporated in the past is to have a very narrow and attractive belly attached to a very wide foot for stability. Scale refers to size. If something is made to scale, it means it has been made the same size as the real object. In other words, life size. Large scale can mean larger than life or simply a large piece. The same is true for small scale or miniature. Many artists are known for working in a particular scale. Rhythm implies visual movement or motion. Here, our eye follows concentric circles to the center of a sphere in an almost hypnotic manner. We watch as a cup ascends a staircase and the rim of a bowl becomes crashing waves. Our eyes follow a parade of figures around a traditional Greek form. Unity is achieved when the elements of art and principles of design in a piece work together to support one another. Unity is achieved in the two examples on the left. The piece on the right exemplifies how the rules of aesthetics can be broken and broken successfully. In this example, corporate logos and digital codes compete with traditional colors and symbols. Forms fight for space and balance is distracted. The key takeaway here is that once you understand the rules of aesthetics, you can begin to break them successfully. Now let's consider expressive qualities. These qualities are used by the artist to give a voice to their work. Examples include mood, tension, message, perspective, and purpose. An artist can share their mood with the viewer or attempt to solicit that emotion from us. These pieces do a nice job of expressing mood and emotion. Tension is edgy and often uncomfortable. It can be provided by a method of construction, the balance of a piece, or a variety of other qualities of aesthetics. Oftentimes, it can be creepy, scary, or just plain disturbing. Many artists use their medium to send a message or make a point. In some cases, they will do this very subtly, and in other cases, quite blatantly. Whether it's Patty Woroshina's China Crisis or Richard Notkin's Nuclear Teapot, it helps to know a little bit about the artist and their body of work when interpreting a particular piece. All artists present their work through their own personal perspective. They choose what the viewer sees and does not see. It may be cultural or historical. It can be an angle of view or an intentional cropping of an image. It's also true that the viewer adds their own unique perspective when interpreting an artist's work. Art is produced for many reasons. An artist's purpose can range from therapy to documentation. The purpose of a piece can tie to academics such as literature, math, or science. It can be created for a ceremony or to commemorate an event. In ceramic pottery, purpose is usually tied to function. Some pieces are identified as functional but are not actually intended to be used, as is the case with the skull teapot seen here. We talk more about functional work in the next section on technical qualities. Technical qualities refer to the artist's approach. Consideration can include materials, tools, equipment, and process. Ceramic artists have quite a variety of materials to consider. The first is choosing the clay body, as we discussed in Unit 2. In Unit 4, we covered some of the many glazes, stains, and colorants available as well. In Unit 3, we talked about some of the tools that are commonly used by ceramic potters and sculptors. Some tools are purchased specifically for working with clay, while others may be made by the artist. Some artists have quite an array of tools they use, while others use nothing but their hands. Equipment varies from artist to artist as well. Hand builders may rely heavily on a slab roller or extruder. Throwers require a wheel, but some potters may prefer a kick wheel or treadle wheel over an electric one. The type of kiln used by ceramic artists can vary as well. We consider different types of kilns in Level 2. We also consider different types of firing methods in Level 2. From preparing materials to adding final touches on a piece, an artist's process can be a very important part of their work. Consider for a moment all of the methods of surface treatment that we covered in Unit 3. As part of an approach to ceramic pottery and sculpture, an artist must consider the functionality of their work. If a piece is labeled non-functional, there may still be functional issues to address. For example, if a piece is intended to be displayed on a pedestal, it may need to be attached to that pedestal. The same is true for a piece that is designed to hang on a wall. An artist may need to plan for that during the construction of the piece. Some pieces are labeled functional, but are not really intended to be used, such as this highly decorative zebra teapot. If a piece is labeled as functional and is intended to be used, important considerations are made to ensure the piece is comfortable to handle and effective to use. That concludes this brief introduction to the four qualities of aesthetics. Now let's consider the different categories of art that ceramic work can fall into. The first is fine art. This typically refers to work that has been created primarily for an aesthetic and intellectual purpose. It is judged for its beauty and meaningfulness. Examples are often seen in museums, galleries, or private collections. Folk art usually serves a functional purpose for a family or community and is tied to a cultural group of people. Techniques and imagery, as well as actual pieces themselves, are passed down from generation to generation. Fantasy art reflects subjects or events from imaginary or mythical worlds. These non-realistic worlds can be created by the artists themselves or inspired by things such as the literature or film of other artists. Pop art highlights images and production techniques from popular or mass culture. Inspiration is found in advertising and entertainment. Pop art often uses irony to challenge the elitist traditions of fine art. Realism in sculpture aims for the precise, detailed, and accurate representation of an object. Critics challenge the creative element of realism, but most agree that the goal is to encourage the viewer to see beauty in common, ordinary objects, while at the same time showcasing the artist's technical skills. Abstract art represents a departure from reality. It can be slight, as in an abstraction of a figure, or complete and totally non-representational. These pieces are admired for their use of the four qualities of aesthetics. Surrealism attempts to allow the subconscious to express itself. It may do this by producing unnerving, illogical scenes, such as creating strange creatures out of everyday objects. Works of surrealism incorporate elements of surprise and unexpected juxtapositions to capture the viewer's attention. Decorative art includes arts and crafts that are designed and manufactured to be both beautiful and functional. Decorative art also refers to all types of interior design pieces as well as the space they occupy. It may also include a facade or other decorative elements of architecture. Conceptual art is art in which the concept or idea represented in the work is more important than the actual work itself. The example here is the concept of opening up one's mind. In some cases, conceptual art is not a stationary piece, but rather a performance. Expressionism in ceramics presents objects or subjects in a subjective manner. The goal is to distort them in a way that will evoke a certain mood or feeling. Pieces are admired for their expressive qualities of aesthetics. As I mentioned earlier, the goal of this unit is to help you analyze, interpret, and talk about works of art. We conclude with 10 terms that may help you when talking specifically about ceramic pottery and sculpture. The first term is series. This refers to a group of pieces that relate to each other. They could have been made with a common theme, method of construction, or within the same time period. Pieces made within a series are not necessarily part of a set, and most often can stand on their own. An artist's palette refers to the colors that they choose to use. For ceramic pottery and sculpture, it refers to the color of clay, stain, and glaze that are used. In this piece, we see a matte color palette of orange, yellow, blue, and brown earth tones. An installation refers to a piece that is set up temporarily. The space could be indoors or outdoors. Installations usually encourage the viewer to walk in and around the work. Sometimes they relate to the space in which they are exhibited. Concentric circles share the same center point or axis. They can easily be a significant part of ceramic work done on the potter's wheel, since the spinning of the wheel creates a natural axis. Banding exemplifies the use of concentric circles. Mixed media refers to work that incorporates a variety of materials that are not commonly used together. Many artists that work in mixed media often used found or recycled material. In this example, we see the combination of wood and clay used in the same piece. Field refers to a particular area of a piece. It could be the sky, the land, or simply the side of a building. In this example, one field is the band of space around the body of the vase where the figures have been drawn. Another field occupies the neck area which is filled with a pattern of oval and circular shapes. Relief is a term used in sculpture that describes a three-dimensional element coming out of a two-dimensional surface. It can be low relief, where just a little texture is created, or high relief, where elements break entirely away from the flat background. This example incorporates both low and high relief. A mosaic is a picture made of tiles. The material can range from clay, glass, and wood to stone, shell, or other found objects. In some cases, the tiles are cut to fit perfectly. Other times, the tiles are randomly broken pieces that have been put together to create a picture. Foreground is the front area of a landscape, and background is the furthest away. The house in this piece has been placed in the middle ground. Some techniques might encourage you to work from foreground to background, as in relief sculpture. Other processes might be easier when working from background to foreground, such as painting or glazing. And finally, the rule of thirds is a guideline which applies to the process of composing an image in art, such as in a painting or photograph. If you visually divide an image into thirds, vertically and horizontally, strong compositions are created by placing important elements along these lines or their intersections. This technique can also apply to form, as seen in the design of this ceramic vase. This concludes Unit 5 on the aesthetics of ceramic pottery and sculpture. Please consider the following review questions to help you prepare for the end of unit assessment. Thank you for watching.